हरिओम, वेलकम टू दिस 10th क्लास ऑफ ओला ओपन लर्निंग फॉर ऑल. एज यू कैन सी द टाइटल इज कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ अवतार एंड विष्णु. सो लेट मी स्टार्ट टुडे विथ अ वैदिक रुचा. ऑफ कोर्स एक्सक्यूज मी फॉर नॉट रिसाइटिंग द रुचा इन स्वर. ओके, आई विल रिसाइट इट एज अ श्लोक, नॉट एज अ वैदिक मंत्र, जस्ट एज अ श्लोक. ओके, त्रीणी पदा विचक्रमे, त्रीणी पदा विचक्रमे विष्णुः गोपा अदाभ्यः अतो धर्माणि धारयन्. एंड द सेकंड इन द सेम ऋग्वेद 1:22 फर्स्ट मंडल 22nd हिम, द नेक्स्ट रुचा विच इज द की ऑफ दिस लेक्चर टुडे, यू नो, तद्विष्णोः परमं पदं, तद्विष्णोः परमं पदं सदा पश्यन्ति सूरयः, तद्विष्णोः परमं पदं सदा पश्यन्ति सूरयः दिवीव चक्षुरातम. आई जस्ट एक्सप्लेन द मीनिंग इन शॉर्ट. द फर्स्ट ऋचा विच आई रिसाइटेड फ्रॉम 122 ऋग्वेद, त्रीणी पदा विचक्रमे, विष्णु टुक थ्री स्ट्राइड्स, देयरफॉर ही इज नोन एज त्रिविक्रम. ओके, त्रिविक्रम, थ्री स्ट्राइड्स ऑफ विष्णु. सो विष्णु त्रीणी पदा विचक्रमे, एंड देन दीज पदा are like, you know, ato dharmani. How is Vishnu? He is Gopa, he is the preserver, one who maintains the world. In the Puranic mythology we have Brahma, Vishnu and Mahesha, the trinity, the creator, the sustainer and the destroyer of the universe, right? So that is Gopa, Gopa, Gupa, to protect, to preserve, to nourish, to maintain. Okay, and adabhyaha, one who can't be injured by anybody, unassailable. So adabhyaha Vishnu, and therefore ataha, that's why dharmani dharayan, he is the one who is called the dharaka, the upholder of dharma, the righteousness or the duty boundedness of the mankind. And the second one which I recited, that speaks of the highest pada, tad vishnoho paramam padam, which is called durlabham. We had seen this once in a samasya purti, takram shakrasya durlabham, katham vishnu padam proktam, durlabham, is it not? Very durlabha. And how is that pada? Tad vishnoho paramam padam, sada pashyanti surayha, wise people always see that. And in another rucha, in Rigveda 1:154, first mandala 154th hymn by Dirghatama Uchathya, he describes this paramapada as madhvaha utsaha. There is a fountain of sweetness, fountain of elixir, honey in that last pada, the last stride of Vishnu, which is diviva chakshuratatam, as if one eye is, you know, stretched from this end of the sky to the other end of the firmament. Okay, so this is again the etymological meaning of Vishnu. Let us just go in detail of who this Vishnu is, what is the concept of avatara in the Puranas and all that. Okay, so this is Vishnu's avatara, Vishnu's concept. Basically we start with what avatara means. Avatara, ava is the prefix and thru is the verb with a ghae as a suffix to that. Ava plus thru, that is to descend, to come down or assume some physical form. Okay, so that is avatara concept. There are 2-3 types in avatara, like Purna avatara, Amsha avatara and Vibhuti. For example, the Gita says, Yad yad Vibhuti mat sattvam, Shrimad urjitam eva va, tat tad eva avagachatvam, mama tejomsha sambhavam. Know all that to be my Amsha. Whatever good you see in every species, in every genre in this earth, know that to be my Amsha. So that is the verse from the Bhagavad Gita. The Latin word for avatara is incarnation. I mean the English word for avatara is incarnation. It is derived from the Latin word carnis, which means flesh. Flesh. We are familiar with the word carnivorous. Carnivorous, who eat flesh, right? Carnivorous, then ambivorous, verbivorous, like that. Okay, so Latin word carnis means flesh, and therefore incarnation is embodied in flesh or divinity in flesh. So that is the incarnation. That's the English word for that. Now, for incarnation, there has to be some principle who assumes or takes different forms. So that is one ultimate reality who assumes different forms. For that, there are ample of illustrations, the Vedic Vachanas. I have quoted quite a few because I am a Sanskrit teacher. So therefore, Eka Eva Rudraha Avatasthe Nadvitiyaha. There is only one Rudra, not the second. This is something like Ekameva Advitiya principle. Okay, one Rudra without the second. Then there will be Eka Ishanaha, one ruler, Ojasa, with his vigor, he rules the entire world, and that is Indra in the Rigveda. Then Eka Idraja Jagatah Babhuva, this is 10.121, this is Hiranyagarbha Sukta, the Prajapati Sukta. So the creator is the only one principle who is the Raja, okay? And he has created everything else. And as in Chandogya it is said, Sadeva Somya Idam Agrasit Ekameva Advitiyam. Without second, there is only one principle without the second. Now this one principle becomes many. That means, what does it happen? I mean, how does it happen? This is the infinite becoming a finite bodily form. Incorporeal becoming corporeal. Indeterminate becoming determinate. Unmanifest manifesting itself, you know, through various bodies. One becoming many, that is the principle. Abstract getting a concrete physical personified form, and then that person later on gets deified. There is apotheosis, and that is how we get the principle of a deity or a god as such. So this is the monotheism of Vedas, which turned into polytheism. According to the Western Indologists, those who study Indology as such, they feel that this is polytheism to monotheism, because Rigveda is polytheistic in nature. It worships so many deities. When we saw Rigveda in the Chaturdasha Vidyasthana, I think we did refer to that. This is just a summing it up. So Vedic hymns glorify many deities and therefore polytheistic in nature. But then there is something like kathanotheism or henotheism. This word was first used by Schelling and then popularized by Max Müller. And that also I told you that alternatively there is a superiority ascribed to one particular deity of the Rigveda. So if it is a Vishnu Supta, Vishnu is the highest. If it is Indra, Indra rules the entire world. If it is Rudra, Eka Itraja, Rudra Eva, Eka Eva Ishanaha, like that. So that is the principle of henotheism. So this is inclusive monotheism, as Max Müller says it. Again, there are various forms. We can hurriedly just read it. Rupam Rupam Pratirupo Babhuva Indro Maya Bhihi Pururupayate. With help of Maya, his various Shakti, Indra becomes many. Rupam Rupam Maghava Bobhaviti. Maghava is again Indra, the epithet of Indra. Ekam Vaidam Vi Babhuva Sarvam Ekam Santam Bahudha Vikalpayanti Ekam Yadangam Akrunot Sahasradha Kiyataskambha. Not only in the Rigveda, even in the Atharva Veda, we have this principle. This is the Skambha Sukta of the Atharva Veda. Then Rupani Deva Kurute Bahuni from Shatapatha Brahmana. So the entire Vedic literature is filled with this principle that one becomes many. And that exactly is the principle behind the avatara. One assuming different forms. So now how does it happen? Ekam santam bahudha kalpayanti. You see this sun rising in the sky. When I talked about Vedic Agni and his epithets and attributes, I did refer to that. So one tejas tattva, one principle of luster or fire, that becomes sun in the celestial world. Then the same becomes lightning in the firmament, in the atmospheric region, and the same becomes the fire on the terrestrial world, right? So this one form becoming many. The original nature, the swarupa, doesn't get lost. But the forms are different. The locations are different. Their functions are different. Their attributes are different. Okay? So creating urge, why should it happen? There is a creative urge, and that creative urge is very well expressed in the Nasadiya Sukta of the Rigveda, Rigveda 10.129. So Nasadiya Sukta. So one becoming twofold, and that is Retodhaha Mahimanaha. The names are also given in the Nasadiya Sukta. One is the seeder, the Retodhaha, and one is the sustainer, the Mahimanaha. Okay? And why this happens? Saekakina Ramate. The Upanishads would tell you this. Saekakina Ramate. He wants some companion. And therefore, Saha Tadaikshata. And what did it think? Bahusyam Prajayeya Iti. And therefore, Aham Bahusyam Prajayeya. So that is the principle behind becoming many or varied form or many fold. Now, Nirukta, which is one of my favorite texts and which is one of the six Vedangas, the science of etymology, but because every lecture I start with etymology, right? So Nirukta is the favorite one. Nirukta has given a rational thinking behind this. It's a very good thinking. In the seventh chapter, Daivata Kanda of Nirukta, you have this discussion. Mahabhagya Devatayaha Eka Atma Bahudhastu Yate. One soul, one spirit. Bahudhastu Yate. It is deified, it is worshipped, it is glorified, praised as manifold. And that is because Mahabhagya. He doesn't say Maha, he says Mahabhagya. So this is not a spelling mistake, right? This is not, Maha is not a spelling mistake. Nirukta says it so. So gods get different names based on their avatara. And not only the gods, even their vahanas. For example, when Vishnu is deified, his vahana, Garuda, he also became the king of the birds. Is it not? Then all his ayudhas, the chakra, the shankha, the kaumoduki, gada, everything becomes a deity then. And in Bhasa's Dutavakya, one of the one-act plays of Mahakavi Bhasa, you have a very picturesque description of Sudarshana Chakra, then the gada, and what else? Shankha coming in personalized form on the stage. Back in Mumbai University, one of my batch of diploma students whom I taught this Dutavakyam drama, they had enacted that scene, you know. And the girl who enacted the role of Chakra, Sudarshan Chakra, she entered the stage taking a spiral movement, you know, like a chakra. So it's a wonderful picturesque description. They are also personified first and then deified later. So Garuda, Sudarshana Chakra and all. Then Surya, Agni and others take a different form to oblige mankind. And that also Niruktakara says, Karma Phala Siddhaye Lokasya Swasmat Swayam Jayante. They are born from themselves. Swayam Swasmat, from their own selves they are born. So again in the Nirukta, what is the form of these gods? What is the akara, the shape, size? See, Shankaracharya in his Bhashya would refer to Nama Rupe. What is the Nama and the Rupa? That is the variedness in the manifestation. So Purusha Vidhaha Syuhu. When these deities, these abstract principles become concrete gods, how do they manifest themselves? Are they like Purusha? Are they not like Purusha, like man? So one opinion is Purushakaraha, Purusha Vidhaha Syuhu. This is typical anthropomorphism. This is anthropomorphism in the Vedic system. And therefore, they are described as having various limbs. Their eyes are described. Their beard is described. Their chin is described. Indra, for example, is called Sushipraha, with a very nice chin, like Shivaji Maharaj, maybe tapering one, pointed one, Sushipraha, you know. And then their vahanas are described. We saw Usha coming in the ratha drawn by the cows or the red horses, right? Or Ratri, the abstract principle, night. She is a lady, starlit night, and she is weaving the cloth of darkness, right? So all this comes as a personification then. Rudra, for example, wears, you know, he is very fond of gold, Rudra. And he wears a very thick golden chain called Nishka. So all these descriptions come once the personification starts, the limbs, the ornaments, their ratha, everything, their clothes, everything starts. Apurusha vidhaha syuh. When there is one opinion, they are like Purusha, other opinion has to be there. No, no, no. They are not like Purusha. They are like, you know, achetana, non-sentient things. And how? Like dice, aksha. We have Aksha Sukta 1034, Rigveda 10th Mandala 34. Then mortar and pestle, ulukhala musala. Then grava, the stones on which soma herb is crushed, is found, you know. Even in the mortar and the pestle, the soma is found, soma valli is found. So they are apurusha vidhaha syuhu because we have deities like this also. That is one opinion. Another would say ubhaya vidhaha syuhu. Why are you fighting? Don't quarrel. Let them be both. Sometimes they have the purushakara, sometimes they don't have purushakara. Nonetheless, they are the deities. Okay? And then karmatmanaha ete syuhu, the insentient would depend upon the sentient. For example, yajna is also deified. Yajna, the sacrifice itself, is also deified. It becomes a deity, but it is not an independent deity. It has to depend upon yajamana. So one sentient, one insentient, so that becomes a combination. So this is all the rational thinking behind the avatara system. Now, when we come to Puranas, after this, I really start the Vishaya Pravesha, the avatars of Vishnu. Because all this, I think, is needed before you turn to what avatars Vishnu has. Okay? The Puranic rationale, as everybody knows, Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutthanam adharmasya tadatmanam srujamyaham paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha dushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. In every yuga, whenever there is a need, I take human form. I am born. I incarnate myself. I assume a physical form for paritranaya sadhunam, for the protection of the good and the destruction of the evil, I have to take birth. Whenever there is a glani to dharma, dharma is on the back foot and adharma is on the rising, then I have to come here, I have to create myself and assume some physical form. So that is the Puranic rationale which we have. Now we come to Vishnu. But Vishnu, as I said, it's not purely a Puranic deity. Though in the Puranas we have Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesha, the Trinity, yet there are so many roots for Vedic Vishnu. Vishnu is basically the solar deity. Vishnu, here it is Vishnu, here it is written here Vishnu. This is a solar orb, okay? So this is the solar deity. I think while discussing Agni also, I told you that this is a solar deity. And the three padas, the three strides of Vishnu are like the rising sun, the sun in the pinnacle, the culminating sun, and the setting sun, okay? So these are the three padas also. And this is derived from Visha, Praveshanath, one who enters everything, one who pervades everything, that is called Vishnu. Vishnu kasmat Praveshanath. Vishnu is called so, that if there is Unadi Pratyaya U to that, Vish is the root and Unadi Pratyaya, and that is how with Nakara as Agama, we have Vishnu, the word, ready with us. Vishnu is described as a sun bird. He is a sun, we saw. In Aztec mythology also, I think while discussing Agni, I have covered some of this portion that Agni is depicted as a bird. Agni is nothing but the terrestrial form of Surya. So Surya is a bird And the word for Surya, one of the words is Patanga. And what does Patanga mean? Patanga is a bird. Patatrin or Patanga is a bird. So it's a sunbird who pervades all the three worlds. So that is Vishnu. And these are some of the epithets like Trivikrama, we already saw the three strides, one who has three great strides. He is Urugaya. Urugaya has got two meanings. Uru is broad, very wide. And Ga, there are two roots, Gang Gatau. Ga is to go, Ga Gati is to go, and Gai Gayati is to sing. Okay? So Gaya is not Marathi Gai or cow. So this Gaya is Urubhihi, Bahubhihi, Janaihi, Geetaha, Iti Urugayaha, Athava Uruhu, Gatuhu Yasya, one whose stride is very broad, very long, you know. In Meghaduta, surprisingly, I won't say Meghaduta, when I talk about Meghaduta, I'll tell you, but there is a reference to the long foot of Vishnu, you know. So it's a very long foot because he covers entire world, you know, in the three strides. So Urugaya, he is Aditya, Aditehe Putraha, then he is Upendra, he is Indrasya Yujyaha Sakha. He is the best companion, best friend of Indra, he is a deputy Indra and therefore Upendra. Upendra was one of the names in the Rigveda and later on it became a synonym for Vishnu. And why Vishnu was called Upendra in the Rigveda? Because Indra is the supreme deity, Vishnu is a bit subordinate. In the Puranas, Indra is nowhere, Vishnu is the supreme. So there is, you know, the shift, the change we can see. Then the Puranas, in the Bhagavata Purana, in the Mahabharata Shanti Parva, there are 10 avatars enumerated. Matsyah Kurmo Varahotha Varahascha, Narasimhotha Vamanaha, Ramo Ramascha Ramascha, Buddha Kalkiti Tedasha. There are three Ramas here. Now first, I think Matsya, Kurma, Varaha, Narasimha and Vamana, they are like separately understandable, right? But what is this Ramo Ramascha Ramascha? The first Rama is Bhargava Rama, that is Parashurama. The second Rama is Dasharathi Rama. And the third Rama is Balarama. Sometimes instead of Balarama, we have Krishnascha. Okay? Ramo Ramascha Krishnascha, Buddha Kalkiti Tedasha. So there are the Pathabhedas. But Ramo Ramascha Ramascha gives you that Anuprasa. So it becomes very nice to hear. And then we say these are the avatars, not of Vishnu Narayana, these are the avatars of Krishna himself. And therefore, the Balarama Krishna comes at the 8th avatar. When they are ascribed to Narayana or Vishnu as the Supreme God, then Krishna comes at the 8th avatar. Okay? So these are the 10 avatars. The first 5 of these, they definitely have, and only these 5 have the Vedic traces, Vedic roots. And because this is a lecture which I want to bring IKS to you in whatever possible manner, whatever little I have studied, like the Vedic references of these avatars, I want to tell you that. Otherwise, everybody knows here, I mean, there won't be any Indian who doesn't know about the Dashavatara. At least 2-3 names he would recite easily, right? Matsya, Kurma and all. So, The first five can be traced to the Vedas. And second important thing is, for the first 5, there are separate Puranas. There is Matsya Purana, Kurma Purana, Vamana Purana, Narasimha Purana, Varaha Purana, okay? So they have separate Puranas of their own and they can be traced to the Vedas. So these five I will take as the Vedic, having Vedic sources. So first is the fish incarnation. Everybody knows that the story, Manu Matsya Katha, the oldest reference is in the Shatapatha Brahmana, okay, of the Yajurveda. Manu Matsya story, it's a very famous story. Once Manu went to a river and while giving oblation, you know, to the sun, a tiny fish came into his palm and the fish said, "Don't leave me here, please save me." So Manu took that fish to his home, put it in a small jar. It outgrew the jar he placed that fish into a bigger vessel, a bigger vessel, a bigger vessel, and ultimately he left that in the ocean. And the fish said that when there is a deluge, when there will be pralaya, I will come and save you. So that is the story. The same story comes in the Bhagavata Purana, and that is not with Manu, but there is some other king, and the Kritamala is the river on the bank of which that king is offering. And so there are some changes, but the main storyline is the same. And this is not only saving Manu, the Saptarshis and the Saptadhanyas, you know, for the next creation, but it is also saving and protecting the Vedas from a daemon who took the form of a horse and went into the ocean. He is called Hayagriva. Interestingly, apart from the Dashavatara, there are 24 avatars also in the Bhagavata Purana, okay? And one of the 24 avatars is Hayagriva avatara. But here when Hayagriva comes, it's a demon who has stolen the Vedas, and Vishnu takes the form of a fish, swims, kills that demon, protects the Vedas and protects this Manu and other rishis as well. Now, flood myth as such is very universal. In every mythology you have it. You have Noah's ark, right? In Bible you have Noah and his ark. In Assyrian mythology, in Sumerian mythology, in every other mythology, you have this flood myth as such. And first living being after deluge has to be an aquatic being. This is again a very interesting thing. The last slide of this presentation will give you that in a nutshell, how the theory of evolution of mankind from aquatic being to the full-fledged human being, that could be related to the avatar system. This is just what you can say, etiological myth or a justificatory myth, as we call it. Okay. When we talk of Dashavatara, we immediately remember, the Sanskrit people at least would remember Jayadeva for his mellifluous songs in Sanskrit, which are untranslatable in any other language because of the sonorousness, because of the beauty and the brevity of Sanskrit language. So he has described these Dashavataras. So I have quoted the Dashavatara stotra of Jayadeva in verse. First is pralaya payodhi jale dhrita vanasi vedam vihita vahitra charitra makhedam keshava dhrita meena sharira jaya jagadisha hare jaya jagadisha hare. So that is the first thing. And here you can see the Hayagriva demon is being killed by Vishnu in the form of this fish. And here is a boat which takes Manu and other people across the ocean. So that was Matsyavatara. Then comes tortoise. Okay, slowly tortoise is coming. Sayat Kurumo Nama. In Shatapatha Brahmana again, Sahayat Kurumo Nama Etadvai Rupam Kritva Prajapatihi Prajaha Asrijat. Interestingly, in the Rugveda or the Vedic literature, be it Rugveda or Shatapatha Brahmana or any other Vedic literature as such, all these avatars are ascribed to Prajapati. It's only in the Puranas there is a shift. These are like transferred functions to the Puranic supreme deity, that is Vishnu. Okay, so the avatars are there ascribed to Prajapati, they are transferred, details are the same, only the name is changed. Instead of Prajapati, which is Brahma in the Puranic mythology, they are ascribed to Vishnu. Okay, so the creator assumed the form of a tortoise. And this is this tortoise in Taittiriyaranyaka of Krishna Yajurveda. It is described as Sahasra Shirsha, Sahasrakshaha, Sahasrapad, which is a Purusha Sukta, which is the description of Narayana, the cosmic Purusha in the Rigveda, right? So he is described, that Kurma is described like that. And he is also called as Akuparaha. A is a negation, Kuparaha, Kum. Prithivim, Piparti, Purayati, Iti Kuparaha Nama Samudraha. This is not a Samudra, but Samudra Charaha tortoise. Akuparaha means a gigantic tortoise. Okay. And in Agni Chayana, in the Shrauta Yagas, in the Soma Yagas, Agni Chayana, tortoise kept in the lower layer, equated to sun because of the shape. Vishnu being the solar deity, later on got associated with tortoise. It is basically because of the shape of the tortoise. It is round and plus these, you know, four like this, the feet and the small tail and the small head, which he can kurumongani vasarvashaha, anytime it can withdraw, you know. So this looks like a solar orb, okay. So shape of the tortoise is like a solar orb. Now this tortoise description in Ashtapadi is kshitihi ati vipulatare tava tishthati prishthe. Tava prishthe. How is your prishtha? How is your back? Ati vipulatara, very vast, very expansive. Kshitihi dharati, prithvi. So kshitihi ati vipulatare tava tishthati prishthe dharani dharana kina chakra garishthe. Why did Vishnu take the tortoise incarnation, tortoise form? To stabilize the Mandara mountain. Why Mandara mountain was shaking? Because there was a Samudra Manthana, okay? The Surasuras did the Samudra Manthana and the Mandara mountain was shaking. So to give the substratum, a base to that mountain, Vishnu took the form of Kachapa. Kachapa, Kamatha. It is also called Kashyapa, and Kashyapa, by the way, is the name of a Prajapati, the creator. He is the creator, Prajapati, which is Vishnu in the Puranas, okay? And this, you know, because of the churning, the Mandara mountain is like, you know, rotating on the back, and therefore there is Kina. Kina is a scar. Dharani Dharana. Dharani Dharana is a mountain. Dharani Dhara. Dharanim dharayate iti dharani dharaha nama nagaha parvataha satyam. Tarhi dharani dharana kina chakra garishthe. There is a circular scar on the back of this kachapa, on this tortoise, the back of the tortoise, okay? And this is the form of tortoise, and that caused a circular mark because of the churning. And we have Matsyadvadashi in the Margashirsha, and in the Pausha, the Dvadashi is called Kurma Dvadashi, okay? And in Matsya Dvadashi, it is said that earth went to the Vishnu, Mahavishnu, save me, there is so much of adharma, and therefore the Vedas are stolen, please save me. And then he took the form of Matsya. So every Dvadashi of all these months is, you know, from Margashirsha to Chaitra, they are named after the Dashavatara. Now, boar incarnation, after Matsya and Kurma comes the Varaha, the boar incarnation. Vishnu killed the demon Hiranyaksha and uplifted the sinking earth. Again, there is Adharmaka Nash and Dharmaka Uttapan. This is the twofold objective of the incarnation. We saw the Puranic rationale, right? So, Vishnu killed the demon Hiranyaksha and uplifted the sinking earth. Magha Dvadashi is called Varaha Dvadashi. In the Vedic literature, the same thing is ascribed to Prajapati. Prajapati does this. Prajapati hi tam, tam prithivim, varaho bhutva aharat, Taittiriya Samhita. And then to the earth, the seer, you know, addresses, udhrutasi varahena, you are uplifted by the boar. Krishnena, how is the varaha? Krishna, the dark, black colored varaha. Shatabahuna, he has hundreds of hands. Shatabahuna varahena. Emusha, his name is also given. Emusha iti varaha ujjaghana saha asyaha patihi iti. So Emusha varaha, that is Prajapati, is the pati of Prithivi. Okay. And in fact, this particular shilpa, I feel it is from the Udayagiri mountain. We have very few Bhuvaraha Shilpas, and this is one of the rare Bhuvaraha Shilpa in Udayagiri, near Jagannathpuri, Bhuvaneshwar. Okay. Now there is a concept, when this whole episode or whole function of Varaha got transferred to Vishnu, Vishnu in the Brahmana literature, which is the liturgical, you know, Karmakanda literature, sacrifices and all, there Vishnurvai Yajnaha, That is a, what you can say, a colophon of every yajna, Vishnurvai yajna. So this Varaha is described in the form of that sacrificial scenario. And Vedaha Padaha. What are the feet of this Varaha? Vedas are as if the feet. This is all a rupaka, a metaphor. This is all metaphor. Yupaha Daushtra. Yupa, the sacrificial post, is the Daushtra. Agni is the Jivha, okay, the tongue. And Darbhaha are the Keshaha. Darbha, the sacrificial grass, is the Kesha of, on the body of the Varaha. And Jayadeva speaks of this. Vasati Dashana Shikhare Dharani Tava Lagna. See, Dashana Shikhare, on the tusk, Dharani, this is the Prithvi, Dharani Tava Lagna, this is the globe of the earth, and here earth is shown in the form of a female deity, okay, a lady. So, Vasati Dashana Shikhare Dharani Tava Lagna, Shashini Kalanka Kaleva Nimagna, this Nimagna, she is merged into your personality as the spot on the moon. Okay? Shashini, Shashi is the moon. Kalanka Kaleva Nimagna Keshavadrita Sukara Rupa Jaya Jagadisha Hare Jaya Jagadisha Hare. Now comes the Narasimha. Narasimha is the most ferocious of all these incarnations. And this half man and half lion form, Nara and Simha. He is Nara also, half man, and the face is that of Simha. You know the story of Hiranyakashipu and Prahlada. Everybody knows that story, right? So he came from a pillar. When Hiranyakashipu just kicked that pillar, the pillar was broken apart and Narasimha appeared. And because Hiranyakashipu was blessed by Brahma that he won't be killed either in the day or the night, in the house or outside the house, all that story everybody knows, right? So he took him and sat on the threshold. It's neither inside nor outside, nor day and nor night. So in the evening time, Pradosha time, so all that story you know. So this Falguna Dwadashi is called Narasimha Dwadashi, most fearful form. And because of this fearsome nature, it gave rise to tantric worship. In fact, in the Brahma Purana, you have the description of Biladwara near Jagannath Puri. If you have visited, I have visited Puri, so I have seen that Biladwara. There is a surang, like a tunnel, and people worship there all tantric things, you know. And this is something like what you can say, some charms or some sorcery, you know, black magic and all. So all that got associated to Narasimha just because he's very ferocious. So that is there in Brahma Purana. For more information, you can always read Brahma Purana. And in Taittiriya Aranyaka, there is this Nrisimha Gayatri. We always say, no, I am Gayatri Mantra ka jap karta hu, or I do the japa of Gayatri Mantra. That is not Gayatri Mantra, that is Savitri Mantra. In Gayatri Chanda, in Gayatri meter, right? Gayatri is the name of a meter and not the name of the mantra. The name of the mantra should be Savitri Gayatri. So this is Nrisimha Gayatri, like Vajranakhaya Vidmahe, Tikshna Daushtraya Dhimahi, Tanno Narasimha Prachodayata. Okay? So there is this Narasimha in the Vedic literature. Now Vamana incarnation. In the Vamana incarnation, I think this is from the Badami caves. If I mistake not, this is from the Badami caves in the Pulakeshi two times. So it's a very nice, there is a very beautiful shilpa of Nataraja the moment you enter in Badami. Very good shilpa of Nataraja. So I think this is from there. I'm not quite sure though. Okay. And this is a dwarf form. Vamana is a batu, one who is short in stature, one who has not fully grown, short, dwarfish. Okay. And he asks Bali for three steps. You all know the story of Bali. And we have in Onam Bali Raja coming, right? In Kerala here, we have Bali Raja coming up. So it's a dwarf form and asking Bali for three steps. Now these three steps in the Puranas, can't you directly link with the Trivikrama of the Vedas? Is it not? Trivikrama, three steps. In the Vedas also, the Rishis mention about three steps. In the Puranas also, it is three steps, okay? In the Vedas also it is Sadadhara Prithivi Mutadhyam, Saskabhayat and Prithivi Imam Rajansi Vimame. This is the description of Vishnu. And Tasya Trini Padani Madhuna Purunani Adhikshiyanti Vishwa Bhuvanani. All the Bhuvanas rest in the three strides of that Vishnu. So that's the description of the Veda, Vedic Vishnu. The same description in a simpler word, in a story form, which is more appealing to the people like you and me, right? So he pushed him to Patala and re-established Indra, but the basic concept is of the Trivikrama, the three great strides, okay? Trivikramatva, very closely connected. Shatavata Brahmana Vamanohi Vishnuhu Asa, clear cut terms, okay? No ambiguity, no scope for any misinterpretation or varied interpretation. Vishnuhu Vamanaha Asa, very clear, okay? Unambiguous terms. Yasya Urushu Trishu Vikramaneshu Adhikshiyanti Bhuvanani Vishwa, Chaitra Dvadashi is called Vamana Dvadashi, okay? So these are like the different avatars. Now we'll see the Narasimhas and Vamanas, the Ashtapadi by Jayadeva, okay? Narasimha's Ashtapadi basically, very ferocious in nature. Tavakara Kamalavare Nakhamadbhuta Shrungam Dalita Hiranya Kashiputanu Bhrungam Keshavadrita Narahari Rupa Jaya Jagadishare. Very clear, his words are very clear, Jayadeva's words. And that Shrunga, and therefore he made Hiranyakashipu as a Bhrunga for the alliteration, okay? For the Prasa Rachana, he wrote it, you know, like this. Tava Kara Kamalavare, in your lotus-like hands. All the hands, the feet, the eyes, everything of the deity is always comparable to lotus, okay? Kanja Lochana Kanja Karakala Kanja, what is that? So Tulsidas also later on, right? Everybody, I mean, compares all the body parts of the deity to the lotus. Tava Kara Kamalavare Nakham Adbhuta Shrungam. Nakha was a shrunga, as if a weapon. Shrunga is not really a horn here. Shrunga here means a weapon. Very sharp thing, okay? It is from this shrunga we have the sharanga, the dhanushya of Vishnu. And the sharanga becomes saranga with anaptixis, with a varanagama. And saranga pani or sharanga pani, right? So how these names are also derived from one another, you know? Nakham Adbhuta Shrungam, Dalita Hiranya Kashiputanu Bhrungam. Dalita tore apart. He tore apart whom? Hiranya Kashipu, Tanu. Tanu, his body. Like what? Like a Bhrunga, like a wasp, like a bee, like a very trivial, insignificant insect. Okay? Dalita Hiranya Kashiputanu Bhrungam. Keshavadrita Narahari Rupa Jaya Jagadishahare. And then the Vamana, Chalayasi Vikramane Bali Madbhuta Vamana. Chalayasi, you deceived that Bali. How is that Bali? He is Vikramane, Bali ka yahane. He hasn't been given any epithet, but he is called Mahabali. Bali was not a very ordinary king. Bali was Mahabali. Chalayasi Vikramane, how you cheated or deceived him. In Vikramana, in taking your strides, you ask for three, the step or the bhumi for three steps, and you took the Virata form later on, Sahasraksha Sahasrapa, and you pervaded the entire universe, and that poor fellow, you know, he didn't have any space left for the third step, and then you put it on his head and pushed him on the Patala. And all that, why, you know, there is a story behind all this, that Bali was such a righteous king. He is a righteous king, okay? And he deprived Indra of his kingdom. Indra is Surendra, Suresh, Suranam Ishaha, Suranam Raja. He deprived him, and therefore Lakshmi also went to Bali. Lakshmi is not Vishnu's Patni Lakshmi. Lakshmi is the Aishwarya. All the wealth, all the riches, everything, abundance, whatever was in abundance, all followed Bali, and Indra was, you know, like a pauper. And Indra's mother, therefore, Aditi, she went to Vishnu. He is also her son. Okay? He is also Aditya. Indra is also Aditya. And she requested him, why don't you help your brother regain his lost kingdom? And therefore, this one took the form of Vamana. There is a very nice story how Vamana cheated, you know, in a way, Diti. Diti, I mean, there is a very long story in Vamana Purana, how he came and stayed with Diti in her ashrama and served her in all her daily course to fetch water, to fetch some flowers and this and that, you know. All those things Vamana used to do. He earned her confidence. And then one evening, while Diti was, you know, very disturbed and she sat her head down on her two feet, you know, she was sitting like 2 feet upwards like this and her head down, and that time, you know, he entered her, Indra entered her womb, and all that story comes. That is a story related in the Vedas of the birth of the Maruts. Now all these 2-3 episodes, they have joined here together. Who cheated Diti, or who came in the form of Vamana? That is Vishnu. And he diverted her mind, and then, you know, Indra secretly entered her womb and killed that fetus. Then he divided that into 7 parts. They started crying, then Maruda, Maruda, therefore they are called Maruts. And then Diti cursed Indra that you will not be worshipped anymore, and therefore we don't have the temples of India. Why Indra is not worshipped in the Puranic era? So all these, as I said earlier, etiological myths, more of etiological myths will come in the Rudra Adhyaya and when we see Shiva. So Pada Nakha Neera Janita Janapavana, this is again a very nice story that from Vishnu's Pada, Pavana Pada, Charana Kamala, Charana Kamalat Vinirgata Ganga, right? So Vinita, this Pada Nakha Neera Janita Janapavana, purifying all the people, that Ganga flew forth, Keshavadruta Vamana Rupa, Jaya Jagadisha Hare, Jaya Jagadisha Hare. Now, after 5 avatars, I told you that I will be taking only 5 because they have the Vedic connection. Okay? The other 5 we might take, we might not take. I mean, they are very well known, like Bhrigu, Parashurama, everybody knows. I thought that the Vedic instances perhaps you might not know, and therefore it was my attempt to bring out that Vedic connection to these incarnations, Puranic incarnations, okay? That has been the topic of my thesis. I mean, the Vedic and the Puranic combination, that has been the topic of my thesis. So I have read all the Puranas, but related everything to the Vedas, the mantras, the worships, the myths, the stories, everything I have tried to relate to the Vedas, the Brihad Devata, which is like a mythology of Vedas in a book, okay, Shaunakiya Brihad Devata. So all that stuff, whatever I know little bit, I would try to reach it to you. So now this is another view for that, how avatars, and there has been some WhatsApp messages, I don't know, they are like, you know, rotating on every group. For a long time I have been reading these WhatsApp messages, how all these avatars are nothing but the evolution of mankind, okay? So I read one book by Acharya Baladev Upadhyay called Purana Vimarsha, okay? He was a great Sanskrit scholar, basically a scientist, then turned to Sanskrit. I value the opinions of such people because they are not purely led, misled, guided or misguided by the Sanskrit textual study as a Sanskritist would be. So these are the people who have worked in some other fields, and then they have studied Sanskrit as their hobby, and they are the ones who can contribute to the scientific side, or the, what you can say, contemporary side of a thought process or a rationale behind everything. And so I value such opinions more, right? Otherwise, when we, I mean, I or people like me, who are basically purely Sanskrit teachers, would tell something, everybody, the listener, would say, oh, you are a Sanskrit teacher. No wonder you would say that. What is the proof for that? What is the science behind that? What is the rational thinking behind that? So let the scientists come. That exactly is the aim of Chinmaya Vishwavidyapeeth. To bring IKS and CKS together, is it not? You are all studying here for the same purpose. So this IKS knowledge is to be strengthened wherever possible by the scientific rational or a scientific approach. Then only we can boast of having the connection with the past and the present and the science and the spirituality and tradition and technology, right? So this is the evolution theory, and he says fish is the first avatar because everywhere we find the first being as such in the water only. Now when we are sending our space missions to say the Mars orbit or to the moon, what the people find there, try to find there, or the robot try to find there, is water. If there is water, there is every possibility of some life on the planet, whatever, wherever they go, right? So what they try to find out first is water, because water is the source of life. It's a life principle as such, okay? So fish being the first, no wonder, and fish stands for fertility. You refer to Chinese mythology also, fish stands for fertility. Water itself is a fertile fluid. Last time I think I referred to Saraswati, and then I referred to her as Haravaiti and Anahata in the Zen Avesta also. And the Parsi women, even now they worship Saraswati, that is Anahata or Haradvaiti, because she is the giver of progeny. She is the river, Payaswati, Haradvati, and all those things. So that is the first thing. Then comes the tortoise incarnation. Amphibian comes next after the aquatic being. Amphibian, one who stays in the water as well as on the earth, that would be the next evolution, step in the evolution. Then comes the boar and the half lion. Boar is little bit more wild, and half lion, half civilized, because nara, and half lion, beastly, and therefore it's a mixture of animal and human. So these two incarnations are the third stage of the development or the evolution. The fourth comes Vamana, the dwarfish prajati, the dwarfish the genre, you know, the species, not yet full-fledged human being, but a dwarfish. And there is a very beautiful Marathi article by one of my professors, my rather model in research is Sadashiv Ambadas Dange, Vaman Butka Khuja. That's typical Marathi word, Khuja. Khuja is Butka. Butka is dwarf. Vaman Butka Khuja. In Vidarbha Samshodhan Mandal journal, he had published that article. Very nice article it is. Vaman, that is the dwarf man. Then Parashurama, he is the first, you can say, full-fledged man, but still nomadic in his style. Nomadic, okay? And then comes Rama, the Maryada Purushottama, the first ever one who stays in a civilized city, fully, you know, urbanized atmosphere like Ayodhya Nagari, okay? So he is the first human being who is staying in a city, not a caveman like Parashurama, or not a nomadic person like Parashurama, but a full-fledged human being. And then Krishna as the Purna avatar. If we say Vishnu is taking the avatar, Krishna comes the eighth. Otherwise, I said Balarama will come in the eighth place. Okay. And then this Buddha is for the assimilation. Buddha comes for the assimilation. Assimilation of different religions. This is the, what you can say, speciality of Sanatana Dharma, of Hindu religion, that Hindus by nature are very assimilative and accommodative. So Buddha's insertion into the 10th avatar, as a 9th avatar, in the Dashavatara system, speaks of the assimilative attitude of the Hindus. That is one opinion. And secondly, because this was a need of the hour. How? Because Buddha opposed the violence in the sacrifice. the animal slaughter, rather not violence, animal slaughter in the sacrifice by propounding ahimsa, and to say that our animal slaughter is not a general rule, you know. So tasmad himsa na yajniya, that is the dicta. Tasmad himsa na yajniya is the principle, but for certain rituals there has to be an animal who is to be offered. And therefore whatever Buddha says is nothing new to us. So that is one way, you know, to propound our own dharma. Otherwise all people would go for Buddhism. So to check that also, it was a need of the hour, as I said. I mean, this is just a rational thinking. So that was the need of the hour, and therefore Buddha got into the Hindu pantheon of gods, we can say, in the Dashavatara, which is the very core of the Hindu pantheistic scene, you know. So that is Acharya Baldev Upadhyay, Purana Vimarsha is the name of his book, okay. Now this is the avatara theory and evolution. With this, I think I'll close with a Purnamadaha mantra. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. हरिः ओम् श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम्।